Do you ever hear Bob Crane's show?
Yes, yes, I did. Mm-hmm.
Who is he anyway?
Bob Crane?
Yeah.
His
family? What's his background?
Well, he's a kid that was born in the slums.
And yes.
He never had a chance. He came to Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And my sister-in-law knows him. She says he's, like he is on the A's, a sweet guy.
Yeah.
And you think desperately of something to say to him because all he has is his background to talk about.
All he knows, yes.
And his poverty, you know. So what can you do with a guy?
That's
but
so wonderful.
He tries.
When these poor kids make a place for themselves.
Exactly,
right.
Exactly. Because you take your average kid who has had
everything.
He's not going to try to be a disc jockey.
No.
He's not going to make that long climb.
No.
Why
should
he?
These people are driven by, their own,
urge.
Insecurity.
Yeah.
And,
it comes out of ambition, but it's insecurity as far as I'm concerned.
Can I have another cup of coffee?
Yeah.
After that opening, I'm not sure I should tell you. This is Bob Crane again.
Oh, hello there.
Hello there, Charlie. This is our special 5th anniversary program for the next 45 minutes. We've got a couple of features we think you'll like. We're going to have Jonathan Witters, who was our in-person guest during this past year, with us. We're going to have Nichols and May again and, so many other people. And we do hope you'll stay with us because this show is just for you, dear.
For me? Oh, nice.
Oh, yeah. Oh, dear. This is our 5th anniversary show and a very happy good Saturday afternoon to you. This is Bob Crane. And it's rather strange for us, of course, to be on a Saturday afternoon. We're usually here in the morning from 6:05 to 5:10 during the week, and on Saturday we're on from 8 until 12 noon and, the usual type thing. But today being 5 years here in town, we decided to have a special show set aside from our regular type things to repeat some of what we consider the best of our endeavors over the past 5 years. Since coming here to town from back east. And, of course, when this was first announced, we were going to have the best of Crane for 5 years. Quite a few people said, what's going to end up as a station break? And, cute things like that. My own engineer had that to say. When I said, Jack, we're going to do the best of the year, the best of 5 years, in fact.
That is a ginger peachy, splendid, paramount, cardinal idea.
If you are just waking up and you suddenly find yourself coming down with a headache, 9 out of 10 doctors themselves have found that there is nothing like aspirin to get rid of the pain. That's a pretty sweeping statement to make, but we can make it. Because it's our show, and there ain't nobody going to tell us what we can say. Now, the bakers of Bayer Aspirin do make a delicious aspirin. There's no such thing as a delicious aspirin. I'm so used to saying everything's delicious, You fall into these things. The makers of Bayer Aspirin do make a good aspirin. Over 4,000 doctors were asked if they themselves took aspirin, and 90% of these doctors said yes, and that's not surprising. After all, doctors have recommended aspirin for years. In newspapers, magazines, personal consultation, aspirin is the one thing doctors consistently recommend. Of course, in the newspaper ads, it's usually an actor that's doing the recommending, but what do you know? This consistent that's not a very nice thing to say to a listener, is it?
No,
what do you know?
No, I would.
I could tell you what the secret ingredients are in these.
No, don't. No, I don't want to know.
You don't want to know.
No.
You want to be just a...
I just want to go on using it.
A Bayer aspirin.
That's right.
There is a technical name for it.
I don't want to know. Thank you.
All right. I
don't want to know. Thank you very much.
All right. Aspirin is what doctors themselves take, so
what is it?
Chicken fat and bulls. And for the youngsters, get flavored Bayer aspirin for the children. Bayer aspirin, the best aspirin the world has ever known. And you know what we want to do now.
Oh, I know what you
mean. You know what I want to do now. We're going to repeat one of our interviews that we've done over the past 5 years, when we've interviewed something like over 300 different personalities, from Marilyn Monroe to Rock Hudson to the fellow that shines our shoes here in the building.
Robert Crane.
We've had
Robert
him on.
Crane,
yes.
That's one of the most sterling thoughts I've ever heard of.
Yes. Hmm. Probably one of the strangest interviews we ever had was the day we had both Pat Boone and Georgie Jessel together. It was one of those things. It was actually a goof up in our calendar, and they both ended up here. And here we've got Georgie Jessel, who originated everything that could possibly be thought of in life. And Pat Boone, who doesn't drink, doesn't smoke, he doesn't, he uses no profanity. And in fact, I was asking him how come his movie company, known as Cougamooga, where did he get the name? And Pat said it's because when he gets mad lots of times because he doesn't use profanity.
And I found myself,
yeah,
just not meaning to, but I found myself saying Great Cougamooga now and then, you know, because I don't swear and I sometimes have to say something.
You don't kiss or anything, do you?
No, I don't kiss, swear, drink. I just wear white shoes and have children.
What do you think of that, George? What do you think of that? I mean,
well, I think that... Are you going? I know what to think of it, but I'm not going to say it.
He's a liar?
No, no. He probably has. No, I don't think that Pat has many vices.
No.
In fact, if they do, I'm sure his virtues outnumber them. And.
Oh, really? That's
Cucamonga,
right.
I mean, I think that's a.
That's almost a vice in
itself.
It's a
nice sound, Cucamonga, and I must make a note not to hear that again. By the way.
What?
I see through this window here some of the loveliest looking girls. I had no idea.
No, George, no, George, no. You're here for an interview now. You think you're coming in here to recruit. You're mistaken, frankly. And I knew you were going to ask that.
No, I tell you, I'm so intrigued.
Pull the microphone in, George.
So intrigued watching you, and I had never been to one of your shows. I listen to you religiously. In fact, that's one of the only religious things I do. And I'm fascinated by what you're doing. Just what it is you're doing, I don't know. But I've never seen so much accent in my life. Drum, and he's got all kinds of things over his ears and all sorts of concoctions. He looks like... I'm trying to think of what he looks like.
He looks like an astronaut. That's what he looks
either
like.
Either that or a Jew who's gone mad.
Oh, dear. Well, that'll give you an idea of what's been happening over the past 5 years with our interviews. Georgie Jessel and Pat. What did you think of that, Jack? Jack Chapman, by the way, is our Jim Dandy engineer. Been with us over 5 years now. What did you think, Jack?
Huh?
What did you think of the interview? We just played a portion of the interview.
Oh, I'm sorry. I wasn't listening.
Thanks a lot. You know the strangest thing? And in old-time radio, this could never be. Today, Jack Chapman is probably more widely known than I am. I can go out, make personal appearances. People don't know me. You know, they can't see me. You'd be surprised how many people can't see me. But anyway, Jack has a feeling that he is the important one. Even in playing records, he doesn't think the singers are important, the musicians, nothing.
Musicians mean nothing, the singers, the dancers.
Yeah, I know.
None of them mean nothing.
I know, Jim.
And it's true, because if you don't have a good engineer, you're never going to get to Cleveland. Now, I'm going to tell you about tape. Now, I'll tell you about tape. Now, you take a piece of tape like this, and you put one piece over here on one side of the mouth, one piece on this.
No, that's not the kind of tape, Jim.
What am I doing? That's the wrong kind
of
tape.
That's not the tape. Put the right tape on.
A tape machine, you don't use that kind of
tape. Right, you put the
right tape on. Like for bandages or something like
that. Put the right tape on. This is just to show you what a great engineer can be for a show. Go ahead.
Altogether different.
Yeah, altogether.
You put the tape on this side, and then you put it through a little thing over here, and then you twist it around over there, and you put another reel here, and then you turn on the machine, and here's what you hear on the tape.
Winston tastes good like a cigarette.
One of the all-time great engineers.
Up front in the tobacco end.
Always gets things absolutely perfect.
Winston gives you filter blend.
Thanks to the keen-sightedness of our engineer.
Up front in the tobacco end.
The flavor comes from filter blend.
All right, give us the message there, Charlie.
Yes, Steve, you're more than half 9 years.
Oh, am I, Jim? Jim. Oh, Jim, you got the tape's backwards. Jim.
How about that? That's backwards.
Well, put it.
Well, I'm gonna fix that.
Will you
see, when you hear a tape that's put on backwards like that, it sounds, you know, like it's really ridiculous.
Well, put this.
But
thing
that isn't the way it is,
right,
because then when
on
you turn it around and you play it forward, we're gonna re-thread it over here. I put it over here, play it forward for you,
and
now you are going to see what it really sounds like.
Winston tastes good like a cigarette should.
You should have left it the other way.
Filter Blend, Winston's own combination of golden, flavorful tobacco, specially selected, then specially processed, is why Winston tastes good like a cigarette should.
Winston tastes good like a cigarette should.
That's it. Winston does taste good like a cigarette should. And over KNX CBS Radio in Los Angeles, 1070 on your AM dial and 93.1 on your FM dial, this is Bob Crane on this Saturday afternoon with sort of a fifth anniversary show. Been here 5 years now doing the morning show Monday through Friday from 6 to 10, and on Saturday we're on from 8 until 12 noon. Jonathan Winters was our in-person guest around 6 months ago. And we did what Jonathan calls winging it, which means ad-lib, a routine, where we only knew what we were going to do, but not where we were going to go with it. He was the Hollywood movie producer, and I was the young, aspiring actor trying to get a job, and this was the scene. Listen.
What is it, Bob? What kind of work, what do you want to do here? What are you doing here, by the way? Who's the agent? What's his name? What's his name, Bob? What's your agent's name? Quickly.
I'll be honest with you, I never met
him. How'd he get through the gate?
I never met him before.
You never met him before,
not
huh?
My agent.
What, did he find you in the street or some discovery in over an ice cream cone?
It's a big...
What, are you talking about the old days, Bob? What do you want to do, Bob?
It's a big company, sir.
Sure, it's a big company. It's a billion-dollar company, kid. We got him going there. You're trying to tell me my business? Maybe you want to come behind the desk.
No, I don't
What
mean...
do you want, sweetheart? What is it, baby?
Oh, now, see, you...
Want to be up there beside Marlena? Is that it?
You get the
wanna
wrong...
Want to play Beau Geste again for
no.
kids? We're putting Willard Foster in it. Crazy kid. He's 14 years old, but he memorizes in 2 seconds.
But my agent told me that I was very good.
Did he?
Yeah, he said
What's
so.
Good about you?
Well,
what
I...
have you done?
You really want to
what
know?
What have you done? I really want to know. I'm not interested for 10 minutes.
Well, you talk so fast, I can't get...
Of course I talk fast. It's
Why?
A fast world. We got to wrap a series up in 26 minutes.
Oh,
sure. Burn a kid out and he's through by the time he's 30.
Well, the agent said to me, go in there and you're a very big man. And
That's
you could,
right, I am.
You could help me.
And big he's... physically and mentally.
Well, if
I'm
he...
overweight and overtaxed, overtired, and I'm over the hill. It's that simple, kid. 75 pills a day, 16 syringes, and 5 bottles of juice. That's what keeps me going. 14 institutions in 5 years.
I've done little theater.
Little theater?
Yeah.
Stay with it. What you ought to do is stay in little theater the rest of your life. Get a little tiny place. Go off the beach. Get your friends to come in Levi's. You know, let their hair grow long. Play banjos the rest of your life.
No.
Don't come on here. It'll drive you crazy, kid. It's
but
a big thing.
He told me I was right for the picture. He read
They're making a housing project out of the whole lot. It's over, kid, for me and you and everybody. It's all going to pay TV. I've got a job for you in radio as a jockey. How'd you like that?
Be happy. Go away to Zuma
Beach and work out for a day.
No, you see, sir, I'm trying to get out of that. I don't want to get out of it because it pays well, but I want to get into the acting thing, and I've been, you know, the agent told me that I'm right for the part. He read the script, and I thought you were producing a picture. That's why I'm here. I mean, you start hollering at me like you've been doing for the last 10 minutes. It's not my fault.
I'm sorry, kid. I suddenly looked at your face and saw myself. You're it, Bob Crane.
You mean I got the part?
You're our next leading man. You'll be bigger than Peck, bigger than Spencer Tracy, anybody out here.
Well, what made you change?
I love you.
That's it. Jonathan Winters and yours truly doing the movie producer and the aspiring actor. And by the way, I never did get the job. And I want to thank Jonathan for being or taking the part. You were taking a part there, Jonathan, right?
Yes, I was.
Come on. Not your voice. Look at the time. It means we've used up everything we possibly can. We've played what we felt were the best portions of our last 5 years here on the station.
I must say, when Bob Crane puts his mind to something, we are certainly winding up with thrills, aren't we?
Yes, and we would like to thank the over 300 people who have been our guests over the past 5 years for being with us, and everyone for listening today. And this is Bob Crane. I also want to thank our fine engineer, Jack Chapman, who spends so much time with us, of course.
My time is your time.
All right, Jack, come on, please.
I'm just a magazine.
It'd be some funny someday if I found out he was reading Rudy Dalek. This is Bob Crane saying until Monday morning, early in the morning. Goodbye, honey.